There is an endless song echoes in my soul. I hear the music ring. And though the storm may come, I'm holding how can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King. Let me place my heart want to I will lift my eyes in the darkest night, for I know my Savior lives, and I will walk with you, knowing you see me through, and sing the I keep from singing your praise. How can I ever say enough? How amazing is your love? How can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my want to sing. And sing in the troubled times. Sing when I win. I can sing when I lose my step and fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up. Sing 'cause you are there. Sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call you to you in prayer. Sing, for I know that I sing with the angels and the saints around the song. How can I ever say how can I keep from shouting your name? I know I am loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I'm loved by the King, and it makes my heart. I'm loved by the King. I want to see. I want to see.
Man.
Please be seated.
Created to live in the Pacific Northwest.
Thank you.
morning.
Good, good. I'm going to tell you guys a story of something that happened to me when I was in college. Don't worry, parents, it's clean. So when I was in college, I went to La Sierra University. How many guys are planning on going to college? Yes, good. Well, La Sierra has a program called Adventist College Abroad, where they send students down to different parts of the world, and I got to go to Argentina. How many of you know where Argentina is? What continent is it in? South America. Good job. So here's us, and Argentina's all the way down here in South America. It's up there on the border. So it's about 11,000 miles away from here, which is pretty far. So while I was down there, my friends and I decided to take a little trip, and we went down to Buenos Aires, which is the capital of Argentina. Now, the university in Argentina is called Universidad de Plata, which is about 6 hours away from Buenos Aires. So when we went down there, we went at night, we finally got to the bus stop, we got in a cab, and we go back to go to the place where we're staying at a friend's house. So when we get there, I take out my wallet, I pay the cab, I get my stuff, and I forgot my wallet in the cab. And the cab took off. I run after the cab, try to find it, and it took off. What do? My money's in there, my driver's license, my credit cards, everything. And I'm 11,000 miles away from home. What do? So I call another cab, I borrow some money from some friends, and I go back to the bus stop, and I find the cab. But he'd already had two more people in the cab. I look everywhere, my wallet's gone. Completely gone. What do? I check my pocket, it's not there. I look all over my bag, it's nowhere to be found. I get down on my knees and I pray. And I get this sense saying, it's okay, I got it, watch this. But how? I mean, South America, I'm so far away from home. So I go about my day, I go around, I borrow some money from some friends, hang out in Buenos Aires, I come back home, and the lady that I was staying at goes, hey, I got all your credit cards and your driver's license. The cash is gone, the wallet's gone, but I got all your stuff. How? How did that happen? So apparently, after the taxi took off, somebody else got in the cab, found my wallet, took all my cards, and then threw them in the trash. And then a Christian family that was sitting outside saw it all happen. They grabbed all the cards, they saw my student ID card from the university that I was staying at, called the school, and they're like, George is staying at this house. They called that house, and I got all my stuff back.
Amen.
So no matter where you are, no matter how far from home, God is always there, he's always listening, and he always wants to be held accountable.
Amen. This is my earnest plea, more love, O Christ, to thee, more love to thee, more love to thee. Peace and rest. Joy I crave, so peace and rest. Now thee alone I seek, give what is best. This all my prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, O thee, more love to thee. More Let sorrow do its work, come grief or pain. Sweet are thy messengers, sweet their refrain. Let sorrow do its work, come grief or pain. Sweet are thy messengers, sweet their refrain. When they can sing with me, O love, O Christ, to thee, O love to thee.
Some have recently found news that they had diseases that strike terror in our hearts. Lord, I just ask that you will bring comfort, draw near them, lift their eyes to look at you and see that you are there right beside them. Lord, we have members of our own church family here who are struggling with health issues, and we just want to lift them up. We've got Jim, we've got Brent, we've got Sandy, and we've got Chuck. We've got others. We've got Joanna on her way to the doctor right now. We have prayer quilts, Lord, that are out there. Many of us have signed or have tied knots and offered prayer on those people's behalf. And we just ask that you will encourage and strengthen them. Lord, when we think about the things that we've done in our own lives this week, we are humbled by knowing that you are so perfect and we are not. And Lord, I'm amazed by you, how you love me. Lord, you come to us when we're battered, when we're bruised. When those batterings are because of our own actions or those of somebody else. We may have caused somebody pain ourselves this week. We ask that you will bring forgiveness and healing in our lives and make it right with those that we are wrong. Lord, we thank you for bringing us here where we can sing praises to you. We can join our voices with those next to us, those in front. And we are blessed by the words that we have sung. And the melodies carry with us through the coming week. Lord, we come here to hear your word spoken through Pastor Viana. And we just ask that you will lift her up to you, fill her mouth, her heart, with words that will fill our hearts and change our lives. Lord, we want to be ready for you when you come back. And we know you want to take us home. Again, we thank you for being willing to be with us today and be a blessing in our lives. We pray these things in your name, Jesus, and for your sake. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. love. I also want to shout out to Jonathan Eady. Jonathan, if you're watching, I know you're in the hospital, and we wish you were here with us, so we just want to make sure that you're being loved. My husband, if he's watching, he's in Florida. Hey, babe. Today we're going to talk about the church being persecuted. And I want to compare two communities, our community and the early church community, because this entire month we've been talking about the early church. We're following the curriculum for Sabbath school, and next month we have a completely new topic, which are the names of God. And it's going to be so powerful. So today, as we wrap up the early church, I want to highlight our community first. Our community needs truth. I feel now more than ever. And we have gotten to a point where truth sharing is very, very complicated. Because we all have ideas, we all have opinions, and we all have different versions of truth, right? And which one is more important? Mine. Clearly, my version of truth is most important. And so as we continue this fight of my truth and your truth, it starts to mush up into this relative truth conversation where there really isn't a truth. That's whatever you believed to be right. And that has led into this sad reality where sharing our opinions, sharing our beliefs, especially if you're part of an online community or social media or forums, I don't know if it's just me, but if you've ever tried to disagree with somebody online, you get shot down. We call that trolling, and people who are just out there to destroy you at every turn possible as soon as you raise your voice. I mean, it can be something as simple and as complicated as parenting, right, parents? You want to parent a certain way, and then there's somebody that doesn't agree with how you're parenting. How dare you not have organic grass-fed diapers? Like, how dare you not? I've heard. No rumors. And so the effects of having this kind of relative truth has turned into a community of bullying. Right, kids, you stand up for somebody in school, maybe. Like, well, don't talk about them that way. And all of a sudden, like, you're the target. You're like, oh, you think you're tough. And, you know, you get shot down for standing up for people. We have this fragility in our views. We have a fragility in discussing and having opinions. And all of a sudden, if there's somebody that we respect that disagrees with us, we're like, well, yeah, maybe that's true. And I should maybe not even say anything, and we have a fragility when it comes to sharing, because if we dare to share, we know that we will become the next target. So we comfortably go into this circle and culture of agreeing to disagree, right? And we've learned to disagree well, but we don't always learn to disagree well. And some of us go even further into saying, well, everybody can believe what they want to believe. Just don't hurt me. Just don't attack me. And I won't attack you. And we can all go on our merry way. And I've heard things from people saying, well, I can do whatever I want to do, or they can do whatever they want to do, as long as they're spiritual. And there seems to be so much of a need for truth. And in fact, Peter's community was struggling just as we are struggling today. Peter's community had this false religion that was being sold on every pulpit of every synagogue or every street corner of what religion was supposed to be like. And Peter and his community in the early church knew that there was a truth that was not relative and subjective to whatever the situation was. It was one truth, it was an objective truth, and that truth was worth sharing at all costs. And that truth was that Jesus is God, and Jesus is the Savior, the Messiah. And they were going to preach it from every corner possible to counteract that false religion that was happening. They knew that Christianity was not meaningless, And it didn't just have to be random conversations. It needed to be a Christianity that was built on relationship with the Messiah. And Rabbi Zachariah put out this quote last week, and I want to share it with you. Christianity is not a religion or perspective. It is God's self-disclosure in Christ. It is built on and built through a relationship with our Creator. And this truth was about to be blown up into every single country, nation, tongue, people, tribe. And yet, the consequences were persecution. Now, I know most of you in this audience grew up with persecution being a trigger word. I don't know if it's just me. My grandma would talk about the persecution at the end of time, we'd run to the hills, and I'd just start trembling when she would tell us these horrifying stories. But persecution is real today, just as it was back then. So I want to dive deep into the story for today. If you want to follow along with me, it's found in Acts chapter 12, verse 1 and on. Love this story. King Herod, not the one who was trying to kill baby Jesus, it was his grandson. That King Herod was not in a really good political situation, and in order to gain favor with the leaders of the Jewish community where he was serving, he knew that he had to do extreme things, and he knew that these Jewish people really did not like the Christians. And so he made the math in his head, and he said, well, if I get rid of the Christians, maybe I can win these people over, so let's start killing the Christians. And King Herod went after the biggest leaders of the Christian community, the first one being James. And as soon as he killed James, the Jewish people were like, yes, one down, one less on the streets preaching about Jesus. And King Herod was like, maybe if I go after their biggest leader, Peter, maybe then I can completely win favor with these Jewish leaders. So guess what he did? He went to go find Peter. And he caught Peter, he tied him up, he took him into jail, and he was like, yes, finally I will eradicate this crazy Christian movement that's happening. And the Jewish leaders were rejoicing. The night before Peter was going to be jail, and it was dark, and it was the middle of the night, King Herod had made sure that Peter was not going to escape. So at all costs, he bound him with two chains, and some around his wrist and around his whole body, and he put four squads of soldiers to surround Peter. So there were soldiers in every door and everywhere that he could turn, just like we saw right here at Sabbath school with the kids. They surrounded Peter so that he wouldn't escape. That night, middle of the night, he was sleeping, and an angel appeared to Peter. He said, wake up, put on your belt, put on your robe, we're gonna leave. And Peter wakes up, has no idea what's going on, sees this being that's compelling him to leave jail, and almost, I can imagine Peter being in this trance, like, okay, what's going on? Like, what? So Peter's like, okay, all right, we're leaving, and the chain that was around his wrist broke, and he's like, all right, well, let's go. And they walk past the first guard, and the first guard was moving, and I can almost imagine Peter like waving in his face, like, do you see what's happening? Is it just me? Am I going crazy? You can't see me? Great. And then they snuck past the second guard, same thing. Nobody knew what was going on, and Peter was like, and they came to the biggest gate, the one that was the entrance to the city, humongous gate, and just before they reached it, the gate just opened on its own, and they kept walking, the angel left Peter, and that's when Peter kind of just snapped into reality, and he's like, whoa, now I'm sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting. Verse 11, he snaps out of it, he realizes he has to get out of there. I mean, what if the soldiers come running after him? What if they realize that Peter's no longer there? I mean, this is it for him. He runs over to the house of Mary, the mother of John. And this community, as soon as they had found out that they had taken Peter, they started praying fervently. So this group of people was in this house praying for Peter. Peter comes out to the door, and they're still praying, really focused. And Rhoda, the young girl, comes running to the door, hears Peter knocking, and like, "Hello, who is it?" Now remember, this community is scared because they're next. They're going to be killed next. And it's like, Peter says, "It's me, open the door, quickly, they're coming." And Rhoda was like, "It's Peter!" And she runs back into the house, and she tells the people, and Peter's like, "Oh, hello, did you come listen? Can you please?" And Rhoda's telling these people, saying, "Peter's outside," and they're like, "Nah, you're a problem, little girl. It's probably his angel." And Peter kept knocking. He was sure the guards were right behind him. And finally, they're like, "Wow, somebody's knocking." They all come to the door. They realize it's Peter. They want to celebrate. And Peter was like, "Shh, can we take this attack guy? They're probably right behind me. Just shh, keep your voices down. Let's go." And they go inside the house, and Peter tells them what just happened in jail, the miraculous story of the angel of the Lord. And I want to pause right here, because three things were happening in the early church in Peter's community. One is that they were afraid, and with good reason. Two, they were hiding, and with good reason. But three, they had not stopped praying. And the verse that I completely love about this is verse 17. Peter pauses to tell them something that would completely change the course of the early church. He said, "Go tell this to James and to all the believers. That might not mean much for you, but for me, it was Peter's call for these people into action." Almost as if saying, as a believer, we can't be in hiding. We can't live in this fear. We can't just pray behind closed doors. We have to go tell the truth about a God who exists and is so big. And you have to tell everybody. It's worth sharing. And the community did just that. And they continued to be the truth tellers. And that is what our church was founded on, truth tellers. Cody, do you know how Herod died? He was eaten by worms. Isn't that so gross? Herod was eaten by worms. So that's how the story ends. All right. So just as the church was built upon truth-telling, I feel like it's what our church needs most right now. And Pastor John shared a couple of weeks about sharing your story. And it's not just sharing our story, which is one of the most powerful ways to talk about Jesus. It's also to share the truth, the story of Jesus. So telling the truth comes at a price, and that's persecution. But Peter was sitting at the feet of Jesus at the Sermon of the Mount when he heard this message, which is also for you. Matthew 5, 10, and 11, Jesus was saying, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they revile and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Your highest calling is to be a light into this world and to share the truth. Amen. Now, we are going to put an end to this debate today. The truth that we need to shout from every rooftop and every mountaintop is this. Fifth and sixth grade started a baptismal class this week. Raise your hand if you were in my baptismal class this week. I know some of you. All right. And we saw a verse. We read a verse that I want you guys to think about. 1 John 5:11-13. And this is the testimony. Pay attention. This is a testimony. God gave us eternal life, and this life is in his Son, Jesus. Whoever has a Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son. Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. Yes, telling the truth comes at a cost, which is why it's so important to share stories of how God has shown up for you when you have been in your deepest or darkest moments of your life. Because when you're scared, all you have to do is remember where He has brought you. So I reached out into the community of Facebook, and I asked people to submit stories or videos of how God has shown up for them through these difficult moments. And I shared Jim's story in the morning in the first service about how scripture was some of the most encouraging things that he encountered during this difficult moment. I showed a video about a Navy chaplain who lost his job, his wife lost his job. And I want to read to you a story from Laurel Haglund. This is what she wrote to me. Having breast cancer was definitely one of the darkest and scariest times in my life. Finding out you have cancer is just the beginning of a journey on the road of unknowns. It's hard for me to pinpoint a single moment I experienced God's grace and sovereignty, because my walk was filled with a thousand such moments. But if I had to choose from all the gifts and blessings, I would say it was the peace He gave me. Peace from surrendering my life to Him, and peace from the hundreds of prayers said on my behalf. His peace was present during my core biopsy. I felt it at each and every chemo session, at surgery, and all through my recovery. I know there is a loving God because of the underlying peace I had in the midst of the storm. Heidi Steffen shared a similar story with me over the phone when she was in the ICU. And the ICU was packed with people. I'm sure some of you guys were there in the ICU with Heidi. And she shared that she could feel, palpably feel God's presence with her in that ICU room. Damaris Matthews said she didn't have a story, but check this out. I was born under legal segregation, but this system didn't personally cause me any suffering. My life seemed extraordinarily blessed, and that I was included and wanted by various social groups as I moved through life. For example, when I was an eighth grader, my school integrated, and the popular white girl welcomed me as her new best friend, and the teacher chose me as the classroom monitor. When the class considered an outing, the teacher boldly declared, "If they don't take colors, then none of us are going." In high school, the librarian took me under her wing, and the girls' counselor volunteered me for a paid job at the city clerk's office. Throughout the various phases of my life, people sought me out and pushed me forward for leadership and honors, even when I was not looking for them. I don't know why God has kept His guiding, protecting hand over my life, but I am so very grateful that He does. I also had a friend, Matthew Frias, a theology student who is now a Bible and religion teacher in South Korea, and he submitted this video for you.
Around this time last year, I began the struggle of the text in Matthew 6, I think 31, where it says, "Don't be thankful."
Hello, everyone. I'm here on the campus of Sanyuk University. I just finished speaking here at the church. I'm just responding to V's question of how God has shaped me in my difficulties. As a missionary, it can be very difficult, you know, living away from home, living in a different country. But one thing I've been reminded is God's sending out, and where He talks about in Matthew 28, 19, and 20, and where He tells us to go, to make disciples, to baptize, and to teach people about Him. But I'm also reminded of His promise to us, where He says about talking about, "I'm with you even to the end of the age." And so, as a missionary, I'm reminded of that verse of where God tells me that no matter what I go through, no matter what struggles I face, He is with me to the very end of the age. And so, friends, I want to encourage you and to tell you that God is with you. God is with you every step of the way, and whatever process you're going through, whatever struggle you're going through, He is with you to the very end of the age. And so my blessings to you, my prayers to you, and I thank you for listening, and may God continue to guide you and bless you in all that you do.
Another one is by my friend Midian Maron, who's in the back listening. He didn't know I was going to call him out. This guy has mastered 25 instruments. I met him when I was a starving student at Campus Hill. Campus Hill was offering a free lunch and Bible study on Wednesdays after chapel. So naturally, I joined for the free food. And that's where I met Midian. And this was Midian's story for me. I lost my job in my application for a work visa. And that was nine years ago in San Diego. I moved back to San Bernardino and attended the Sabbath-keeping church in Roland Heights. The founder of the church was once an Adventist. Didn't like Ellen White and detest her writings. He doesn't require the giving of tithes. So I stopped giving tithes. After about a year of going to that church, my wife and I decided it wasn't the right church for us. So we stopped going there and started attending Sabbath services at Campus Hill. I learned about the Bible study group led by Pastor Larry Christoffel, which met every Wednesday noon. Since I had no job at that time and no direction in life, I attended the sessions. I enjoyed it so much that I came faithfully every week. It was there where I came across Malachi 3 once again. I've read this chapter numerous times in the past, but it was at this very moment when it hit me real hard. On Sabbath morning, I decided to place all the money I had in the offering bag at Campus Hill. It wasn't much. It wasn't even $100. But it was all I had, and I gave it all to Jesus. The following day, I got a phone call. It was a mother who wanted me to teach her children music lessons. While I was still talking to her, there was an incoming call. It was another parent who wanted to enroll her child. This happened a couple more times. Each day, that whole week, I had someone calling me on the phone requesting music lessons. My schedule was so packed that I stopped accepting students. Before the year ended, I presented a recital with my 50 music students, the most number of students I ever had in my whole life, at the Waterman Philam SDA Church. I praise God for keeping me his promise that if we bring the tithes into his storehouse, he's going to pour upon us his blessings, that there won't be room enough to receive it. The last story is, thanks to those Bible studies at Campus Hill, like Pastor Larry Christoffel, went to another church, and I volunteered to lead up those Bible studies because I had grown so attached to the retired community that attended. I mean, retired community members, they're so funny, they have no filters, and we became family, and I love this church, so I'm like, I want to keep this going, so I volunteered. Slowly but surely, and you guys know the rest of the story. Pretty soon, and there are so many times when I'm wanting to quit, and my story is, and those dark moments, God has shown up for me. This week, in fact, in the mail, I haven't shown any of you, maybe one or two of you, I got my commissioned minister license. And for me, that was such a confirmation from God. You see, we are a community of truth tellers. The church grew when the gospel truth was shared, and our church has been commissioned to take the gospel truth to every person, not just some. Every person, every nation, growing in discipleship and baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So I want to invite you to use every opportunity you have to tell the truth. Amen. To be a truth teller, even Amen. If you know you might be persecuted. Amen. Your story is one of the most powerful ways to share Jesus. Share all the stories, especially when the going gets tough, so the believer can remember what God's glory looks like when we share the truth. Powers. He delivers, and he exists and shows up in the darkest times, and he keeps all his promises, especially when you share the truth. The last testimony I want to mention is about a woman who is undercover. Her story is mentioned in John chapter 4. This woman was undercover. She would go in the middle of the day to a well where nobody could see her or interact with her. This woman had been searching for truth, and she had been searching in husband after husband, and now currently her truth was adultery or fornication. In this encounter with Jesus at the well, he called her out and said, I know there's been a feud between God's people over where to worship and how to worship and the right God, and the truth has kind of been all over the place, and I know you've been searching for it. So here it is. I'm going to put an end to everything. There's a living water that once you have it in you, you will never thirst again. And this woman was like, fantastic. Where is it? Jesus said, I have that living water. And she was like, you didn't come prepared to draw water. And Jesus was like, I am the living water. You can have me and have that living water in you. And so the new truth that just came upon her at that very moment was she was inspired to become a truth teller. And so the Samaritan woman realized that God had shown her the truth that she had been searching for, and it was a false truth. And he had just given her a new truth that having the Messiah was all she ever needed, and that's what she was truly looking for, and it was right in front of her. She pivoted, left her jar, went back into town. And verse 39 says, many Samaritans from the city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them. And he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his word. And check this out, they said to the woman. It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world. And that's what happens when you become a truth teller. One of the ways that I want to inspire this generation in our church to be truth tellers is through our drama ministry. The fifth and sixth graders should be preparing. There you guys are. Get into positions. We have a skit that I want you guys to remember so you guys can be truth tellers from now on. You guys are on.
Yeah. Amen.
I can't believe you finally found that power source. We're like a lighthouse. Awesome!
This way. Ouch. What's a guitar doing out here anyway?
Hey, is somebody there?
Yes. Who's there?
Who are you? Did you see a light here earlier?
We're over here. Follow me.
Oh, jeez, guys.
Oh, are you okay? I'm Jennifer. Just my friend back.
Yeah, hi. Thanks. I'm okay. I'm Darren. What are you guys doing out here? Did you see a light here earlier?
I'm trying to find it, but it seems to have gone out.
Actually, we were trying to figure out what to do with it.
The light. You have the light?
Yes.
Is the switch on?
Yes.
Is it plugged in?
Yes.
Well, where is it?
Under the trash can.
Okay. Why? Because we didn't want anybody to see it? So what you're saying is you have a light and you turned it on, but you don't want anyone else to see it? But we're all stumbling around in the dark.
Yeah, that is a problem.
Which way are you going anyway?
I don't know. It feels like I've been wandering around in the dark forever. Hold on. Is this better?
Yeah, but wouldn't it be better just to take the whole thing off?
Yeah, but we've heard it's a little bright.
Look, I'm not telling you what to do, but if you have something that can save people from the darkness, I don't think you should hide it. In fact, if you don't mind, I think I'm going to follow your cord so I can find a power source and turn on another light. We can drive away all this darkness together if we keep sharing it. Take care. I hope you figure it out. This is not working.
Maybe we should try the button. If one didn't, then it would turn it out.
Worth a try. Two. To drive out the darkness, to make people see what can trip them up.
But now we're trying to hide it?
Doesn't make much sense, does it?
Nope.
You know what? If people want to stumble around in darkness around us, they may just have to wear some shades. Take off that bucket, Jennifer.
Yeah, now that's better.
Lord, let your light, light of your face, shine on us. Lord, let your light, light of your face, shine on us. Let your light shine on us. Grace, Lord, let your grace, grace from your hand pour on us. Lord, from your hand fall on us, that we may be saved, that we may have life to find our way in the darkest night. Love is no hand, come over us.
you showed up in times of darkness, of persecution, of bullying, and emotional terrorism. Because there's a truth and a story we're sharing. So shine your light on us that we may reflect and pray. Pray this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.